Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and today we're going to be discussing a new interesting visitor to the International Space Station, the visitor being the Blob, sort of named after the 1958 horror movie also known as The Blob. And if you've never seen this movie, it essentially features a slimy organism that sort of grows bigger and bigger and starts to consume everything around it, including humans, and eventually even bigger objects. Anyway, I'm not going to be spoiling the whole movie, and in this case, it's not really that blob that's headed to the ISS. It's actually this one right here. This is known as a slime mold, and this is, in my opinion, one of the most fascinating, if not the most fascinating, organisms on the planet that's been used in various studies for many decades now. And this video right here you're watching is also in the description below, which is a really cool visual art project from an artist by the name of Heather Barnett, where she essentially uses this mold for various experiments just to see what it does when you put it in a certain situation. Anyway, this is a really fascinating organism, and there's just so much to discuss in regards to it. This is an organism known as Physarum polycephalum, and it normally resembles this. Although sometimes it also resembles something like this. So it does kind of look like a mushroom, and because of this, it was generally considered to be a fungi or a mushroom for an extremely long time. And at least visually, it does resemble a mushroom. But not so long ago, the scientists realized that this is actually not a mushroom at all. As a matter of fact, this is an organism that completely defies modern biology. Because even though it sort of resembles a mushroom, in reality, this is actually a single cell made up out of multiple nuclei. A single cell that, as you can see right here, is growing without ever dividing, which makes this an absolutely fascinating organism. And there are so many other things that make this organism extremely fascinating and somewhat weird. Now, first of all, generally speaking, what you're looking at right here is just one of the forms of this organism. Physarum can actually live in different forms. So, for example, this form right here, this happens when there's just not enough food in the environment, and suddenly the mold tries to find food elsewhere. And so it starts to actively search for the food by combining all of these cells into one large cell, and by then trying to explore the environment, as you see right here, searching for the signs of potential food source. But when there's a lot of food in the environment, each of the individual nuclei starts to separate and creates its own tiny cell, its own tiny amoeba, with each of them living their own separate lives until there's no more food left again. And at that point, they once again create this large cell, start to look for food, and if nothing is found, some of the species are even able to create these mushroom-like formations, which generally just sit there waiting for something to pick them up to take them to a new place. And that something could be anything, an animal, a gust of wind, or just something brushing against it. But because it kind of looks like a mushroom, back in the days, the scientists believed that this was a fungi. Turns out that it's not a fungi, or a plant, or an animal, but belongs to a category that's never really been classified very well. The category we refer to as protists, which really makes these creatures especially interesting, mostly because a lot of them have really unusual features that no other species has on the planet. So, for example, when it comes to reproduction, instead of having two genders like most species on the planet, many slime molds will have up to several hundred, with this species in particular having anywhere from 500 to maybe 900, which of course allows the species to differentiate extremely quickly and to also survive even in some of the more extreme conditions. And so generally speaking, when we talk about slime molds, we really are referring to this unusual organism that normally lives as a free single cell, but sometimes comes together into a multicellular reproductive structure that the scientists sometimes refer to as the blob. A slimy, slow-moving organism whose only purpose is to find more food. And interestingly, in this state, this organism also acquires some absolutely incredible features. First of all, they acquire an ability to sense the environment, sense chemicals, sense pressure, and even sense light, and possibly some other things we haven't discovered yet. They also acquire an incredible ability to create these very complex structures and to move around using what's known as the chemotaxis, following the chemicals. But more importantly, the scientists over the past few decades discovered that it also seems to have an ability to learn, to remember, and possesses some really complex problem-solving abilities, which is something that I guess a lot of people didn't really expect. Which is where we come to this important point of this video, intelligence. This organism seems to possess intelligence, but not the type of intelligence that animals have. At least not the intelligence where you need to have a brain, neurons, and electrical stimulation and electrical signals in order to be defined as an intelligent species. Because we know for a fact this has no neurons, this also has no electrical activity on the inside, and so there is no complex brain involved when it comes to intelligence for this particular species. Yet with absolute certainty, most scientists today would actually refer to this as an intelligent species, as something possessing intelligence. As a matter of fact, in several different studies, this strange mold has already showed the scientists what it's capable of. It was able to solve mazes that normally have only been solved by mice. It's also been shown to have very similar features and very similar behavior to what we usually expect from a social insect such as a bee, with one example being something like this. When all of the cells inside the slime work together to create some sort of a stalk-like formation, with the bottom cells sacrificing themselves in order for the top cells to be transported somewhere else. But more importantly, time and time again, the scientists have been able to show that this mold is able to solve some really complex mathematical problems when it comes to pathfinding, with one really famous example being this unusual map of Tokyo created by the Japanese scientists. By taking several pieces of oatmeal you can see represented as white dots and placing them in various regions representing the map of Japan, specifically the map of metropolitan Tokyo that's today considered to be the largest city in the world, they observed the mold itself create the shortest pathways to each individual city, and within 26 hours it actually created the shortest possible paths and the most efficient paths to each of the locations, which represented an almost direct copy of the subway map of the metropolitan Tokyo. And so when presented with several food sources, it's able to solve the shortest path problem by creating the optimal routes to every location where the food is present. And very similar experiments have been conducted using other city maps, including the maps of Spain, Portugal, and United Kingdom. But it's not just able to solve these mathematical problems, it's also able to somehow remember. It seems to have memory. To test this, the Japanese scientists essentially changed the environment the mold was growing in every 60 minutes. They would basically make the conditions extremely cold and extremely dry. And so after a while, they stopped doing this, but the mold was anticipating the changes. It actually prepared itself as if the conditions were about to happen. And that is not something we expect from a simple organism that does not have a brain. It's something that you usually expect from something that does possess some sort of an intelligence. And to top this all off, some of the scientists have even created a kind of a robot, with the mold itself being responsible for the locomotion, or essentially the movement of the robot itself, with the actual control being somewhat simple and looking kinda like this. And as soon as it learned to control the robot, it essentially moved it to the location that the mold prefers to live in, a dark and a somewhat wet place, something you can learn more about in the paper in the description below. And so what all of this shows is that this unusual creature, this organism, is able to solve a lot of really complex mathematical problems, without generally understanding what math is, of course. But it doesn't just solve them, it also remembers some of the solutions. So this paper right here, for example, once again showed that this organism is able to remember certain types of substances that it doesn't really like. And so when the scientists introduced a substance that the mold didn't really enjoy, it ended up creating a lot of really complex shapes just to escape the environment. And so all of these discoveries are slowly helping the scientists to figure out what exactly intelligence is, or what features an organism must have in order to possess intelligence. Obviously, we always believe that the brain was absolutely required for this, or at least some sort of a primitive neuron system with some sort of an electrical charge responsible for the signals. But a lot of modern studies are discovering something entirely different. In some of the future videos, we'll actually discuss the idea of intelligence in bacteria, which has also been discussed in many papers. But as the study of the slime mold shows us, intelligence seems to arise even if there is no electrical stimulation, electrical signals, or neurons. At least primitive intelligence that's able to solve simple problems and is also able to remember things. But I guess in this case, you can still make certain analogies between what slime mold becomes when all of these cells come together and to some extent a typical brain as well. For example, if you actually look at what the mold is doing to move around, you'll notice that it actually pulsates extremely quickly. And by pulsating, which involves a lot of expansion and contraction, it's able to effectively propagate across really large regions, but only in a direction that's most beneficial. And generally, when the mold encounters some sort of a food source, like sugar, it actually starts oscillating much faster. And as it starts to oscillate faster, the entire organism sort of moves in the same direction. And this is extremely similar to the oscillations we normally detect in a typical brain. But in this case, you would refer to this as a hydrodynamic system, whereas our brain is electrochemical. And so one of the most recent experiments wanted to figure out what it's able to sense in the environment in order to determine certain locations of motion. And so in this paper you can find in the description below, the scientists wanted to investigate how various physical cues would change the behavior of the slime mold. And it turns out that the mold itself is able to sense various mechanical depressions and usually prefers to move toward a certain direction, which could also be related to some type of a memory or because the mold prefers to move toward a certain direction. So when there was slightly more deformation on one side compared to the other side, the mold generally moved toward this side. And just to test this, the scientists decided to disable some of the genes responsible for this mechanosensation, the ability to sense the mechanical structure around you. And today the scientists know that in animal cells, this type of mechanosensation is done by transient receptor potential channels. And these are the channels that essentially allow us to taste things, to feel temperature, and to feel pain. Basically, this is how we sense the environment around us. And in a lot of different experiments with flies, these receptors have previously been blocked in order to show that the flies stop feeling certain things. And so today we have different chemicals that are used as a kind of a blocker for these types of receptors. And when the scientists added these blockers into the slime mold, the same thing happened. It stopped sensing things. It started moving into random directions, which I guess has some implications. It implies the mold also seems to sense things, or appears to sense things. Now, does it feel things? That's of course another question. And that's not a question we can answer anytime soon. But the important revelations from all of these studies are really in helping us sort of understand that intelligence takes many different forms. And for someone studying astrobiology, it also means that we can hypothetically find all sorts of intelligences out there. It really means that the brain itself is absolutely not a requirement for finding intelligence elsewhere. With this 500 million year old creature serving as a perfect example of intelligence at work without having a brain. Which also means that we sort of need to redefine our definition of intelligence at some point in the future. But remember, it only acquires these extreme abilities when things are not going so well, when the environment around the mold is no longer able to sustain it. This is when all of the tiny amoeba come together, form a single massive organism, with some of the smaller molds then forming some sort of a large, massive blob-like formation. And so this is a result of a massive collaboration of billions of different cells, with some of the cells choosing to sacrifice themselves in order to allow other cells to survive. But I guess one question that a lot of scientists wanted to have answered is, what would happen to this mold in space, in zero gravity? And so what sort of behavior is it going to exhibit in microgravity? What direction is it going to prefer? Is it going to go sideways, or will it actually start forming three-dimensional structures? And so right now, several pieces of this mold are actually headed to the ISS. So this is something that scientists are currently going to be investigating in the next few weeks, in the next few months. But it also sort of serves as a very interesting school experiment. The scientists in France are also distributing the same pieces of the same mold to various schools, to various high schools, in order to create the copy of this mold in various environments there, basically to encourage students to learn more about it, while also realizing that exactly the same mold is in space doing its own thing. And so this is definitely going to be a pretty interesting study to follow, and something we'll talk about in some of the future videos once we have more detail. Until then, there is definitely so much more to cover when it comes to Physarum polycephalum, but I just can't do all of this in one video. We're going to come back and talk more about this in some of the future videos, simply because this actually relates directly to a lot of other things we talk about on the channel, including of course the idea of extraterrestrial intelligence. And so until then, thank you for watching, subscribe if you still haven't, share this with someone who loves learning about space and sciences, and maybe come back tomorrow to learn something else. Maybe support this channel on Patreon by joining the channel membership, or by buying the Wonderful Person t-shirt you can find in the description. Stay wonderful, I'll see you tomorrow, and as always, bye-bye.